All rise. You may be seated. Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Nancy's family, I want to thank you for coming today. Over the past few days or weeks or months or perhaps even the last year, I'm sure many of you have dropped in or visited in some way with Nancy to offer your love and support. The flowers, the kind words, the prayers, the visits, I'll speak of your love for Nancy and her family. Once again, thank you so, so much for coming. Your presence means everything. Just about every celebration of life service begins with the words that I'm about to speak. They have become familiar, but in their familiarity, they have not lost their power. They've retained their meaning and their power because we have learned we can trust God. We have learned that we can trust the witness of Jesus. And we have learned that the Bible, as a testament to God's working in human life, is likewise trustworthy and true. So these words, which have been spoken many, many times before, stand before us as our credo, statement of belief this morning, and on the faith in which we stand in the most difficult of times. Remember these words. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Because I live, you shall live also." Friends, we have gathered here today in this place to praise God as we witness and remember the life of Nancy Carol Hanson. Nancy is gone now from our daily life, but will never be removed from our thoughts and memories. Not ever. Through the wisdom known only to God, we were allowed to know her in the midst of her 81 years. We acknowledge this day that she has returned to God who first gave her birth. She has run the race here on earth. She has finished the course and has been received back into the arms of her loving God. We praise God today because we are assured that God has all of this under his control. He holds all of us in his hands. He holds the key to life and death. He is the one in whom we place our faith today. I'm convinced that as we weep today, heaven weeps with us. As we laugh today with good memories, heaven will laugh with us. I know that God wants the very best for his children. He wants the very best. As we gather today with all the feelings that we have, God shares with us in that because he knows the depths of our sorrows. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17 tells us, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. All this is from God." For Nancy, everything has become new. Never again will she be in pain. Never again will she be held back by heart issues or cancer. Now Nancy is a new creation, and she can hug all the people she wants to, her dearly beloved who have gone before her. She has been reunited with them and her God. Nancy has taken her place at the banquet table of heaven. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we realize that you are more ready to hear us then sometimes we are ready to pray. We also know that you already know what we need, even before we ask. And you also know that sometimes we cannot even find the words to pray. So today, we pray for your grace. We stand here today, shrinking before the mystery of death. As we stand in darkness, help us to see the light and the joy of eternity. Continue to speak your message of life and death. And may we, as we remember and celebrate Nancy today, learn the lesson of those who have gone before us. And whether we live or die, give us the courage and the strength to remain always in your grace. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The great hymns of faith often provide comfort in times like today and remind us that the God we worship is sovereign. He is on the throne. He is with us wherever we go. For Nancy, she loved Jesus and the grace that he offered to her throughout her lifetime. And that same grace is available to us today as well, thank God. So let's now turn to that hymn which best expresses the amazing grace of which we speak today. The words can be found on the screen or in your hymnal, number 378. Let us stand as we sing Amazing Grace. We have selected several scriptures for this morning's celebration of life. These selected passages speak to God's provision and his protection and his promises of everlasting life that has been fulfilled for Nancy today as she lives in glory with Jesus. Members of Nancy's family will read our scriptures for us this morning. So I'd like to call Nancy's family members up at this time.
Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
My verses come from the last conversation that Jesus had with his disciples the night he was betrayed. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me, that you will also be where I am. You know the way to where the place I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
I'm reading from the book of Colossians 3, 1 through 4. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory.
Two Corinthians 5, 1 through 4. For what we know, that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. For while we were in this tent, we groaned and are burned, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life.
Thank you so much. Now, Emily Hanson, I'd like to invite up Emily, granddaughter of Nancy, who will be sharing some remembrance with us. Emily, welcome.
Hello. My name's Emily. I'm Nancy's granddaughter. She was my grandma, gram-gram, nana, kind of interchangeable. But somehow I feel like those titles aren't enough to truly describe what she was to me. You see, my grandma had a way of filling in all the vacant spots in your heart with whatever form of love you needed. She wasn't just my grandma. She was a friend and a parent. She had a relationship of that nature with so many people. She had a way of becoming a surrogate mother, grandmother, that friend that you've always wanted. My grandma loved feeling connected to people. This is why she was such a natural at stepping into the spots in people's lives that they needed filled the most. I think it was so intrinsic to her being that she didn't even consciously realize she was doing it sometimes. And that is part of the magic that was and is my grandma. She was unashamed in her love for connection. She was not afraid to speak up and make friends no matter where she was at. I was constantly amazed at how much she could find out about a person within just a few moments. In fact, when she was in the hospital, there was a nurse or some sort of employee who told her his whole story about growing up Amish, leaving the community. We later found out that that's something this individual doesn't share with people. And that's just a testament to who she was as a person. There's always been something comfortable about her presence. She was a safe space for me and so many others. She understood that we are all human. She understood the complexity of life and that nobody's perfect. Even if she had an opinion, when it mattered most, she didn't pass judgment. I'll never forget my first heartbreak. I was maybe 13 in middle school. My boyfriend broke up with me and I was devastated. Looking back now, I just laugh at myself because how did I really think I knew what heartbreak was? My grandma certainly did, yet she didn't judge. She sat down in the chair, cradled me in her arms, smoothed my hair, wiped my tears, and said, I know, heartbreak hurts. No placations, no judgment, just the validation that my feelings mattered. This is part of what made her so special. One word that kept coming to mind as I was preparing for today was grace. My grandma's ability to forgive and to extend her love time and time again is something I would like to think I gained from her as well. My mom and I were talking a few weeks ago about how we don't think grandma truly hated anybody. Her ability to see different perspectives, or at least be open to them, is something I have admired and tried to adopt myself. If it wasn't for my grandma showing me the way of grace, I would not have the special final memory of my cousin, Michael, that I do. It was my 2-year celebration of being clean. I was mad at Michael because I knew he had relapsed and I didn't want him there. She made me realize that family meant more than anger, that I needed to extend my grace to him and allow him to be there to support me, and maybe in return we could help support him in that way. Although it didn't work out the way we thought, if she hadn't convinced me to let him come, I wouldn't have heard the words I hold so dear to my heart now before he passed. I will forever be grateful for her teaching me grace in that moment. My grandma was a bit of a contradiction in some ways. She was humble, but she was also very full of pride. She was so extremely proud of every one of her loved ones for all different reasons. She was not afraid to tell anyone and everyone about all the accomplishments we made. You see, family always came first, even until her last days. The day before she passed, after being asleep for a few days, she had a small lucid moment. She opened her eyes and we gathered around and we told her it was okay to go, that we would be okay. And she whispered, "Promise?" I truly believe that's why she held on as long as she did, because she just wanted us all to be okay. I used to be sad for her, thinking she should have followed her dreams of becoming a nurse or a flight attendant, but I've come to realize that I don't think she would have had it any other way. Her purpose in life was her family, shaping, molding, supporting, watching, loving all of us, those that are blood and those that aren't. She took so much pride in all of us, and through that, I know she was proud of herself. I told my grandma so many times, especially towards the end, that she's the strongest woman that I know. I know she's probably hoping we don't try to remember her in her final days, but I can't help but dissect each and every moment. The bravery she showed was inspiring. Her ability to stare death in the face and quietly say, "I'm not afraid," was something to behold. There was a certain beauty to the way she approached death and her transition to her new home that's simply unexplainable. Her river ran deep. She held a lot in from her past, but she never let anything stop her from doing what she knew was right. Her ability to conquer every obstacle life threw at her was nothing short of spectacular. The beautiful thing now is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold her now. Imani asked me the other day, "Mom, can Nana see and walk now?" And I just cried, thinking about the joy she must be feeling, being able to dance and sing and laugh and love and see everything and everyone that she must be seeing right now. My grandma will never truly be gone. She had such a lasting impact on all of us that it would be impossible to wipe her mark from this earth. Something I've come to realize over the last few weeks is I'll never stop experiencing the force that is my grandma. I get to continue experiencing her through the shared memories of all of us. I encourage anyone who feels comfortable enough to approach the open mic during the luncheon and share anything you would like to, funny stories, fond memories, lessons learned from her. Who she is will always be with us, and we all got to experience different parts of her. What joy there is in getting to share those things with one another, keeping her memory and spirit alive in doing so. I've also began taking solace in the fact that as I grow and I get older, I'll continue getting to know her through all the stages in my own life. With every year that passes, I've grown to understand her more and more as a person, and I don't think that will stop even now that she's passed on. I hope I get to live to be her age, surrounded by the family I nurtured, with all the love and strength and bravery she showed until her last breath. I am who I am because of my grandma. That experience, that force, and that love will never be gone. And I just want to thank you all for being here to celebrate her and her life. I think I speak for all of my family when I say it means a lot to us. So thank you.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
For those of you who may not know me, my name is Jim Klepper, and I'm the Director of Education and Contemporary Worship here at Evangel Church in Rochester. I've been blessed to know Nancy for many, many years through Evangel, and she has been my friend. It is a great privilege to be standing before you today to guide this celebration of life service and to honor Nancy. It's also very humbling. So thank you, family members, for putting your trust in me on such a day as this. It is really so good to see you all here today, family and friends gathered today to worship God and to celebrate God's daughter, Nancy Hanson. Love is in this room. It is palpable. And it is so wonderful to be together. I have no doubt after speaking with Ann and Wendy and Holly and Cindy and knowing Nancy myself that Nancy would be delighted to stand where I'm standing this morning, if just to look out and to see your beautiful, shining faces, people who she loved dearly, to know that you're all together here at Evangel today. So if Nancy was with us in this room today, her beautiful trademark smile would be beaming as radiant as ever, that her family and friends are all together. She would be so happy. And so it will be today, as Nancy would have wanted it. We're together to honor God and to celebrate. Today there will be laughing and crying and conversation and hugs and tears and giggles, all produced from a lifetime of living with Nancy. Today is a special day, anointed by our Father in heaven who has orchestrated it all, a remarkable life of Nancy, well-lived, and a good family, sharing in the most important things life has to offer, faith family in Jesus, who is Lord of all. I don't know how many hours have been invested by many of you into Nancy's life over the years, but I'm sure for some, the time is beyond measure. The devotion and love given near to the height and the breadth and the depth of Christ's love himself. But whatever the gift of time and care you've given to Nancy, today you reap a wonderful reward. You have been like Christ to dear mother, aunt, grandmother, sister, workmate, and friend, and now you are released from that care. It is done, finished, accomplished, made perfect in Christ. You were part of preparing Nancy for the moment she would meet her Savior. Only God alone can do what is next for Nancy, namely her resurrection, since God alone knows how, and God alone has the power. This is the easy yoke of Christ for you today. What remains is for all of us to remember Nancy with all the love that she shared with us. Love. It was easy to love Nancy because of how Nancy loved us, especially in her family. In speaking with Ann, Wendy, Cindy, and Holly, and hearing about your love for your mom, Fred, and then through some poignantly beautiful memories the family shared with me, it was so very evident. Nancy's love for her family was the passion, the center of her life. And one of the ways Nancy gave that love was simply being available to all of you, which in itself is one of the greatest gifts you can give another human being. You know, that focused attention, your presence. Did you know there are two ways to spell the word love? There's two ways. The traditional way to spell love is L-O-V-E. But then there's another way to spell it. And that's T-I-M-E. Time. When you give someone your time, it's something you cannot get back. Time is precious and valuable and priceless. And Nancy certainly loved her family by giving all of you her time. Ann said Nancy was the biggest cheerleader for her children and grandchildren. She attended most, if not all, of the sporting events and other things the kids were involved in, even Mark's football games in college. No matter what the weather or the distance traveled, Nancy would do her best to try to be there, encouraging and supporting, lifting up her grandchildren. And you know, when you are there for your grandchildren, you're there for your children as well. One of the greatest gifts a parent can give their child is to be there for their child's children. Nancy gave that gift over and over and over again. And it wasn't just sports either. Cindy said that her children, Grace and Allison, loved going out with Grandma too to places like Flapdoodles for salted caramel ice cream. And Holly said Jimmy loved to go with Grandma to Brainerd and going to flea markets and garage sales as well. Do you see the pattern here developing in Nancy's life? Nancy was investing her love into her children and grandchildren. It takes effort to go to all these different games and places and events. And Nancy's investment into her family was so much more than money or the material things of the world. She made time. She was available. She was present faithfully. And Fred, I love what you said about your mom too. You lived together in these last years of her life, and you said no matter where you were going, the last thing Nancy always asked before you left to go somewhere was, when are you going to be home? You know, that question speaks volumes about Nancy. When you read between the lines just a little bit, there is such great power there because your mom's safety and her security and her happy place was wherever and whenever she could be with you, one of the girls or your grandchildren. The phrase, home is where the heart is, could have been inspired by Nancy Hanson. I wish every family experienced the Nancy kind of devotion that she so abundantly shared with all of you. The time she gave, the places you went together, the support, the effusive kindness and care she offered to each of you. It's a beautiful thing. You will carry that beauty with you the rest of your lives, until you are reunited in eternity. When are you going to be home? Nancy would say. You know, that question works both in our present reality in our world today, but it's also a question that works in our life yet to come in heaven. None of us in this room know when our time will end on this earth, but when it does come, and when we go to the other side of glory, this I do know. Nancy will be there, and she will be waiting for you. And you'll be together again. Home, home, forever home. And what a day that will be. This reunion of our loved ones and all the saints in heaven is one of the great promises of Jesus to his own. And you know, this reunion in heaven we are going to have with Nancy is sure important to her. It was very important to her. When Kathy Dillon and I visited Nancy in St. Mary's several weeks before her passing, this subject came up in our conversation. Nancy was looking forward to seeing loved ones again who had passed before her to heaven. I'm not surprised that where the conversation led, because Nancy was always thinking of family. She was always thinking of friends and people she loved, even the ones who had already passed on. And she was looking forward to the reunion with them as a soon-to-be new arrival in heaven. She knew her time was getting near. And now that she has arrived in glory, she will be waiting for you. When people love you, they wait for you. When people love you, they think of you and they watch for you and they can't wait to see you. Why should it be any different when you walk up the sidewalk to heaven's front porch? It won't be any different. Nancy will be there waiting with her trademark smile and with her trademark lipstick on, because I heard she didn't go anywhere without her lipstick. Maybe you've been to some of the most beautiful places in the world, snow-capped mountains high and grand canyons and massive oceans and flower-laden valleys with a pristine brook cutting through. But just wait. The best is yet to come. When you get to heaven, you'll see Jesus face to face. That will be the ultimate. But then somewhere in your peripheral vision, you'll see her close by, and she will come into focus. Nancy will be there to welcome you home. Fred, I understand you took such good care of your mom while you lived together these last few years, and that you had a very special bond. Thank you for that. I hope you don't mind me saying this, because it's true about myself too, and I even think it's true about Jesus, but one of your sisters told me with the most utmost respect and thankfulness that, like me, you were a bit of a mama's boy. I'm glad you're smiling that I could say that. But you know what? That really resonated with me, because I believe a son's devotion to his mother, especially in her vulnerability, is one of those admirable and noble characteristics of a man. And it's very Christ-like, too. Did you know that from the cross? From the cross, as Jesus was saving the world from sin, Jesus asked John, who was down below, to be sure to take care of his mother. So from one mama's boy to another, well done. You will never regret those years. In fact, you will cherish them. Thank you for all you have done, for following in the footsteps of Jesus himself in caring for your mother. Nancy loved her family, but she loved friends and strangers too. This room was full. This is amazing. Wendy said, to know mom was to love her. I learned how to have an open door from her. And Cindy said, mom always talked to everybody, even strangers. Holly said, friends and family were the most important thing in the world to her. And Ann said, we couldn't go anywhere without mom running into somebody she knew. As kids, we knew we would be waiting for a while as she would talk with them. To illustrate Nancy's gregarious and loving nature with everyone, there are stories of when Cindy was in the hospital as a child, and Nancy was always there with her, of course. And by the end of the hospital visit, Nancy would know all the people who were in the neighboring rooms nearby, who they were and what they were there for. And she would have made friends with all of them. That's amazing. There was another time there at the county fair And the fairgrounds had lost power, and Nancy started talking to everybody, trying to help them figure out what was wrong, how to get the power back. And it wasn't until the end of all that that they realized she wasn't even a fairground employee. And Marty said Nancy was a big help to him, too, as she loved to be his backseat driver, always telling him to get into the right lane. Al Vries stopped by to my office just yesterday morning with another story about Nancy that's definitive of who Nancy was and just beautiful, so I just have to take a moment to share it. Al and Jean's daughter, Laura Vries, was stricken with cancer at a very young age, and she has two daughters, Lizzie and Leah, and all of them just loved dogs. Well, the girls wanted to get a dog so very much, but of course Laura knew that was not possible or wise because the cancer was beginning to overtake her. Nancy heard about this, about Lizzie and Leah's dreams and the difficult circumstances, so what did she do? Nancy brought her dog over, and she would leave her dog with Laura and the girls for big parts of the days. And Lizzie and Leah were so excited to come home from school, wherever they were, to have Nancy's doggy in the house, bringing such joy in the darkest of times. Nancy brought light into that darkness when she brought that doggy into that young family's lives. And her act of kindness has never been forgotten. Laura and Nancy, they might be recalling this story in heaven today as they're together in paradise. And for those of us still here, it's a reminder of how we are supposed to love. This is a life well lived, friends. People first, bringing light into the darkness, lending a helping hand, time given, love shared, family prioritized, friends treated like family. So in other words, everyone was like family to Nancy. Holly said, all Mom ever wanted was for people to be happy and healthy. And so Nancy tried to make that happen, I understand, even in the little things, like always having a wad of Kleenex available in her pocket. Love was like always having Kleenex available for others, isn't it? You know, being ready to help, to provide what is needed at just the right moment. Nancy's work life also represented her love for people, having many jobs throughout her life that seemed to always be championing goodness, championing people. Nancy worked in pulmonary research at Mayo Clinic with the Girl Scouts, the YMCA. She was also active right here at Evangel Church as a volunteer in our church office, as an usher right in the sanctuary in our worship times, and volunteering for our annual rummage sale. As a staff member, I was always really, really happy when Nancy's day to be our volunteer in the office came up here at Evangel. Our conversations were always delightful, overflowing with kindness and just fun. Nancy always left me with a smile, feeling better having had the conversation than I did before the conversation. And I especially loved the times when she would just stop into church with one of her pets, and we would swap dog stories, and I would be on the floor playing with Oreo, and we would just revel in that. Her great love for all God's creatures, especially the most vulnerable ones, endeared me to her all the more. Her tender heart, her gentle nature, love personified. My goodness, friends, this is what makes a person great, getting love right in this old world. Nancy lived the greatest commandment that Jesus ever spoke, to love God with all your heart, to love your neighbor as yourself. A plus, Nancy. You've made the honor roll. You are the valedictorian of your class. And so on a very tender day, just a few days before her passing on Friday, April 14th, as I sat at Nancy's bedside while she was still responsive, I asked her a question, which I knew the answer she would give, but I needed to ask it anyway. I asked if she was looking forward to seeing Jesus face to face. And she said these words exactly, I am. So very much. The next time I visited on Sunday, April 16th, just one day before her passing, Nancy could no longer respond. So those of us in the room, we just sang songs and prayed and held hands. In that gentle time, as Nancy was beginning to leave this world and go on to the next world, she was about to leave loved ones behind for just a little while to meet Jesus, the one who had loved her from before time. It was peaceful and good. You know, friends, these are precious memories, and whereas 81 years is a long time to spend on earth, one is still practically a rookie in heaven, even after 1,000 years. The psalmist said it, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart cries out for the living God. Therefore, it makes sense today as we celebrate Nancy's life to give some attention now to heaven, where Nancy resides today with her Lord Jesus. A Sunday school teacher was quizzing her kids one Easter about the resurrection story, and one of the questions she asked was this: why did Jesus raise from the dead? And one bright little boy replied, because it wouldn't have been much of a story if he didn't. That little boy was absolutely right. Everything about our faith depends on the resurrection. Without the resurrection, Jesus would be nothing more than a dead hero. The history books are full of them. But the good news of the resurrection is that Jesus Christ has blazed a path for every believer into eternity. And even now, this risen, powerful Christ has been loosed upon the world. And he has assured us that there will be accommodations in heaven for anyone who believes in him. Listen to the Apostle Paul's words from 2 Corinthians verse 5, 1 and 4. Jimmy shared these with us earlier. Now that we know that if we have an earthly tent we live in, it will be destroyed. We have a building from God, an eternal home in heaven, not built by human hands. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened. People in the Old Testament knew what it meant to live in a tent. That's why Paul used this analogy. The Israelites lived in tents for 40 years as they traveled through the wilderness and they made their way to the Promised Land. Tents are meant to be used, and when you're on a journey, a tent doesn't last forever. The bodies that we've been given are like tents. They're also meant to be temporary. Nancy's body ultimately wore down, but she lives in a new body now because she has made the trip to heaven, to her eternal home, a building from God. And this today is our comfort. For you see, the love of God gives us, and not this life itself, is the real treasure. Even though our vessels, our tents, become battered and bruised and finally broken through life's pilgrimage, we still have this treasure of love given by God himself. And the love of God goes on forever and ever in heaven. Do not let your hearts be troubled. In my house are many rooms, Jesus said. Now, isn't that ironic? When the Son of God came to earth, there was no room for him in the Bethlehem Inn. Yet when we go to heaven, we won't have to worry about no vacancy signs. A room has been prepared for us. Jesus went on to say to his disciples, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Friends, Jesus Christ offers us a personal escort to heaven. To commit oneself to Christ and follow him as Lord is the road to heaven. And I believe when Nancy approached heaven doors on April 17th, Jesus Christ announced to the throngs of heaven, this is my child. In love, I died for her. And I am here to escort her into her new home. One thing we can know about heaven is the atmosphere is awesome. Imagine a place where no one is ever sick. No one is ever in pain. Each person is valued and makes a contribution. Every child is loved and affirmed. Not a single person is addicted or prejudiced or greedy. Imagine a place where there is plenty of food and living space for everybody, and nobody grumbles about that food or the decor. Laughter and praise are constantly heard everywhere, and you get up each morning eager to be busy doing something right, and every day is spent enjoying others. Reunions of loved ones is ongoing and full of joy. And the glory of God is so pervasive that you can hardly restrain a song. Banished from paradise is worry and grief and heartache and jealousy and frustration and anger. In heaven, you go to bed thinking that life can't get any better than this, but then the next morning comes and it is better. I don't know who made this statement, but they hit the nail right on the head. The light of heaven is the face of Jesus. The joy of heaven is the presence of Jesus. The melody of heaven is the name of Jesus. The employment of heaven is the service of Jesus. The duration of heaven is the eternity of Jesus. And the fullness of heaven is Jesus himself. Now, if some cynic tells you thinking about heaven is escapist or hopelessly sentimental, tell this person this. Only when I have my long-term future secured can I live fully in the present. If I don't know my final destination, I might get confused along the way. The most significant thing we can do on earth is exactly what Nancy gave her life to doing. To claim Christ as Lord. To sit at the feet of Jesus. To learn from the wisdom of the ages. To love people with actions. And then tell of Christ to others. Giving our all to make this world look a little bit more like heaven. It is time to let Nancy go now. We must. But we must also pray for ourselves that we too, by allowing Christ to live in us, shall one day join Nancy and all the saints in heaven. And that will be glory. Remember, she is waiting for you with her lipstick on and that Kleenex in her pocket. Because, you know, we might just cry great joy, tears of joy in heaven, of great joy, when we see each other again someday. And it will be glorious. Love has triumphed here today. Love has won. Our joy and Nancy's joy is complete. Victory through Christ's love at the cross is hers. Nancy has come home to Jesus. And any pain or fear or doubt or heart issues or cancer has been left so far behind her, it will never catch up to her again. Take heart, family and friends. Your beloved is home. Nancy is in the arms of the Lord Jesus, whom she so loves. She is in a place of indescribable joy and beauty. I can only imagine. God bless you and keep you.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by to my knees, will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine. Forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Would you pray with me, please? Oh God, all you've given us is yours. As you first gave Nancy to us, now we give Nancy back to you. Receive Nancy into your arms of mercy. Raise Nancy up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come someday. And Jesus, as Nancy is yours this very day, we pray that you would grant her her greatest joy, to be in your presence, to walk and talk with you as you stroll with her through heaven's gardens, and to sing songs of praise to you with all the saints and all the angels of the heavenly throng forever. We can only imagine. As we offer Nancy back into your arms, comfort us, strengthen us, give us courage to face the future unafraid. Enable us, Father, to know the peace and the joy, which is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please receive the benediction. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always, bringing us together in love. Amen. We have just one announcement for today. As before we depart, all are welcome to join in the multi-purpose room for lunch together. There has been a place set for Nancy with some of her favorite foods as she would have eaten as she watched her grandchildren in their many, many events. So take note of that downstairs when you see that special memory. Food and drink and a rich time of fellowship awaits. There will be an open mic in case you have some stories you'd like to share about Nancy with the group. Once again, thank you all for coming to share in the celebration of life for Nancy. God bless you all.